Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Welcome back from that break. Definitely this weekend, early kickoff later tomorrow. Jose Mourinho, his first game as the Tottenham head coach, will be away at West Ham. That is a conversation we shall be getting into a little later on. Plus, the pick of the bunch, Manchester City up against Chelsea. That is a game we shall be talking about. But first things first, let's talk a bit of motocross, because this weekend it's round 7, the final round of the National Motocross Championship. All roads will be leading to the Lake Victoria racetrack that is down in Garuga. And so many of the riders in the different classes will certainly be looking to pick up the different accolades. Now, it's been quite the journey over the course of the entire season. There's been so much competition. There's two classes that have already been decided, which is the MX1 and the MX2, but the others are still pretty much open. What should we be expecting?
I tell you what, Sunday will be more of like just a summary of what the season has been like, especially for Maxime Van P. I mean, the fact that he returned from injury, got back to winning ways. I still feel we need to have more of Maxime Van P. Out there as far as the continent gets to go, because we know he gets it really flat whenever he gets guest riders coming through. They usually give him a run for his money, but there should be more that should be done from Maxime Van P. I think if I'm going to demand more from motocross, it should come from the team leader and captain in Maxime. That being said, I look at the other classes, the 125, the 85, I mean, the youngsters coming through and try to, of course, also make their name be seen out there in regards to motocross. We've seen how good they have been. We talk about Sebo Guzi, that is the kid who graduated from the 50 senior to the 65. We talk about the dear darling in Isabella Bleek, Fortune Sentimo as well, having, of course, appeared this season at the Motocross Africa Nations Championship. Where you're gonna finish that, Mathai, in that regard. The beauty about MX this season has been that they've gotten more sponsors on board, and the racetracks have been redesigned and put at least up to standard, knowing that next year you're going to be hosting the prestigious event. But of course, this Sunday, we expect the numbers, the usual faces, of course, from all the respective classes. Next season, hopefully for Olivier Van P, who'll be back on the racetrack. Hopefully for Asaf Natan, who has been an irregular rider in the MX1, will come back to be more of a consistent rider. This Sunday should be great to look forward to.
Laureate, next year, Uganda will be hosting the Africa Motocross Championship. All the different racing countries should be coming down here. And the curtains are going to be drawn on the final, edition, round 7. It's still quite competitive across the different classes. Some will be focusing on the MX 125, where we've got names like Fortune Sentimo, where we've got names like Aviv Olan in there. And it's been such a successful campaign in terms of motocross.
Actually, yeah, it has been an entertaining season. Eyes will be on Fortune Sentimo.
Yeah.
I will try to beat Aviv Holland and Ali Bobo, because right now actually it's going into the last race in second position. So I know all eyes actually will be on Fortune Sentimo, but I would have loved to see someone who can actually push Maxime Van P in MX1, but it's so unfortunate that he has an actual competition.
He does, it's just, yeah. He does.
No competition in Asaf. Because actually, in the Armed Forces race, that was.
It was toyed with.
Yeah. It was actually.
It was toyed with,
But in Uganda, he has no competition. But the good thing, there is still competition in MX125,
yeah.
And then
MX85
and 65.
Yeah.
You want to believe that he will get competition in the long run when the Fortunes graduate to the MX1. That is if he doesn't, retire from the sport quite early. But when you mention that he doesn't have competition as of now, he does have one from the white guy, Asaf Natan. It's just because Asaf Natan doesn't take motocross quite seriously. He only shows up when he wants to. But that being said, like I mentioned earlier on, we demand more from Maxime Van P.
All right, certainly that is motocross for you. All roads will be leading down to Garuga, the Lake Victoria racetrack. Let's all come out in big numbers, and it is round 7, the final round when it comes to the National Motocross Championship. But quickly, I am from motocross now. Let's talk a bit of boxing, because the countdown is on 29th of this month. All roads will be leading to the IUEA Auditorium as our very own Shafiq Chuanuka will be contesting for the WBF African Heavyweight title up against the Zimbabwean Tamsa Dube. Now, The countdown is on. Lorian, we've certainly covered this for quite a while here, and interestingly, everyone will be hoping Shafiq can win the title and he keeps it here.
Yeah, actually, basing on the last two fights, most special actually, the last one against Tyson Mbikai. Actually, I want to go and see what's going to happen this time around. I know Ugandans actually, many Ugandans, they will go to support Shafiq Shanuka. He has actually had enough preparations, and I think he's not going to disappoint like it has been in the last two previous fights. Though actually, the other last two previous fights have been actually friendly fights.
It seemed easier than harder.
But actually, I know he has the confidence, and he's not ready disappoint Ugandans. I know he's ready for the task ahead.
Nick, two professional wins, both by knockout. Some will believe it's been easy, like, Lorian mentions there. We saw against the Congolese Mbikai knocking him out in a little under 2 minutes. Can he replicate that against a more experienced fighter?
When you revisit those two bouts, you want to question, Chuanuka's ability to see out Famsanga Dube next Friday. No offense, he's my guy. I follow him a lot, whatever he does. But you want to believe that right now, Chuanuka has the pressure on his shoulders. Many have shown faith in him. Many have actually come out to support him, including Vision Group. That being said, for Chuanuka right now, it's important for him to go out there with a cool head because, like I said, sometimes pressure can actually get to the actual stage, knowing that there's something at stake, not just the belt, but also the money as well, can get to your head and you might falter because boxing takes a few minutes and you're out. One bad, punch in the face, you're out cold. But Famsanga Dube, according to the reports we've been getting, he's been breaking cars for fun. When you look at his body size, he's a giant and he's got physique. What Chuanuka has over him is the height. And when you have height in boxing, you look at your opponent right below you. And that for me might work out for him. But the question again will be, how much steam will Shafiq have knowing that he's actually been banging out his opponents in under what minutes? Can he last out 3 rounds, 4 rounds against a giant like Famsanga Dube? That is something we, of course, will be hoping to find out next Friday. But that being said, for me, Shafiq Chuanuka is a champion in the making. He's got the self-belief. He's got the confidence. He's got every right to believe they can actually go out there and upset the big man in Famsanga Dube.
All right, exactly 7 days to go next Friday, IUEA Auditorium, and we hope we all come through in big numbers. Let's get to cheer on our very own Shafiq Chuanuka. He'll be hoping that the WBF Africa heavyweight title definitely does get to stay here. But quickly, I am from boxing now. Let's talk a bit of football because action in the Uganda Premier League does return today. Two games on card, both kick off at 4:30 p.m. First of all, Proline will be up against Police, and then the other one will be at the Prisons grounds in Luzira, while the side Maroons will be up against the table leaders, having lost the unbeaten run against KCCA. Vipers will be going on the road. Two big games, and hope for Vipers. They know they've got to go and pick up those 3 points at Maroons.
Well, it's a tricky contest for Vipers. They want to get back. Yeah, we have seen Maroons, by the way, give some teams a hard time. Most especially for me in the Premier League this time around, it's so hard to predict what most of these midfield teams will, bring to your, to your exposure. So I think for me, for Vipers, what's going through their head at the moment, they have to bounce back from the defeat against KCCA, maintain their momentum. maintain that momentum. And the good thing is that they have really, they've been doing well. They're not conceding a lot of goals. That, the style of play has really changed this season. Some of the players out injured, some of the young lads are still out doing exams. But I still feel Gora has a lot, in his team that can deliver against Maroon. Like I said at first, it's a tricky contest because Maroon also would want, bounce back and get a good result.
Nick, for Vipers this particular season, they've looked like the team to beat. Their first loss coming in that outing at the Lugogo Stadium against KCCA. Somehow, much will be on Fadbio and company. Can they recover from that loss and keep the run going?
They have the right quality to actually recover and not get a win. But she mentions the word tricky. And for me, I think it's rightful in a way because Maroons are in desperate mode. Why? They've gone 4 games winless. Back-to-back draws before losing out to Proline the last time out. So that for me puts But Mwen and his men in desperate mode to come out and get something from this game. Can they get a win? It's a bit too much to ask. Can they get a draw? I think that would be an upset for Vipers. That being said, of course, Vipers will be favorites to come out on top and get all 3 points, get back to winning ways. The question for me in this game will be how well can Maroons also recover from those four league games where they've gone winless. But most importantly for Vipers, to win these winnable ties, to keep your title hopes alive.
Stephen Mokwali has been the top scorer in the league so far. Fired by on the other side as well. Is this a battle of the two top scorers in the league?
It would have been, but the unfortunate thing is that Mokwali is not going to feature into this game just because he's still a first player on loan at Maroons. So that's actually the good news for Vipers. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, will be on Fadi Bayo. When you look at actually the statistics, Vipers has dominated this fixture. In the last six meetings, Vipers actually picked up 4 wins, the others ending in draws. So for me, Maroons, without their top scorer in Stephen Mukwala, I think actually Vipers does whatever it takes to pick up maximum points and lose 0 today.
Okay, the other game is the relegation dogfight. Police up against Poline, two sides that have blown hot and cold for Police. Yeah. They've had all sorts of issues. Abdallah Mubiru in and out, committee international team, and then also for the club as well. For Proline, docked 6 points at some point, and they are looking to continuously climb up the table.
I think for Proline, I've really put that past their shoulder. Now looking at the games in the UPL, if you look at their last three games, they've done quite well. 4 games, 2 draws, 2 wins, and 2 draws. So I think they would want to bounce back and get out of that relegation zone. The players, I think, know that this time around, they don't have anything to play for, most especially in the continental level. So much, by the way, talked about the points that were doxing, the money that they had to pay. So it was too much on them. But this time around, the team looks to be, you know, bouncing back to winning ways. And for Police FC, to be honest, I've already said this. I know Vipers is winning. The unbeaten one was just ended by KCC. But I don't think there's any team in the Uganda Premier League that plays good brand of football better than Police. But the way they concede goals is still a big question. And I don't know how Mubiru is going to, you know, go about that. They're also, you know, on a good run. But again, it's Proline. I think teams that are both flirting with the relegation would want to get out of that.
You've got to feel for Proline. I mean, she mentions unbeaten in the last 4, 2 wins and 2 draws, but still rock bottom. Had they not had their points docked, maybe they'll be in a whole different, you know, space mode. But Police as well, they've had their, you know, fair share of problems, knowing that Adam Obidu was on the verge of being sacked when they won their last game out, I think, against Toro United, the 4-0 victory, though without Abdullah Bawiru. So the question again there was being posed that are they that good without their main tactician? But Police FC are right now in the right mode to come out and believe they can actually get all 3 points. Two sides that are really battling and struggling for form. But when you look at the back-to-back wins for Police FC and the unbeaten four-match for Proline, I think they deserve to have some sort of kind of like 3 points for each in that regard, but should be a very good game of football down in Lugogo.
All right, two games on card for the fans, both kick off at 4:30 p.m. Police up against Proline, and certainly Vipers heading away to Maroon. So head out there, get to catch some beautiful action when it comes to the Uganda Premier League. But quickly, away from the Ugandan League, let's talk a bit of women's football, because this particular weekend, the Crested Cranes will be battling it out for a place in the finals when they come up against the defending champions of the SEKAFA Challenge Cup, that is Tanzania, and that promises to be the cracker. Unfortunately, in their final group game, the Crested Cranes lost out to the Kenya Starlets by 3-0. So they'll be out to put that behind them going into the big game coming up against Tanzania. Lorian, for the Crested Cranes, they've certainly had quite an interesting cup performance. 13-0 against Djibouti, edged the game against Ethiopia, and now they lost against Kenya, but they've got to put that behind them as they come up against Tanzania.
They struggled against some of the good teams. I remember that game against Ethiopia. It was 1-0 for Crested Cranes, but they did not put up that solid performance I expected. Then against Kenya, 3-0 loss. I think it was a wake-up call, because after the game, Ayub Khalifa was saying that it's a wake-up call, but they still have hope in the team. They can come back home with the trophy. But it's going to depend on their performance. But they need to improve a lot, because at the way they conceded the goals against Kenya, that poor defending, they need to go back to defense. They need to sort out things in their defense if actually they are going to manage to come back home with the trophy.
Hope, certainly you've covered this team for quite a while, and I'm very sure you're looking at these girls and thinking they've done an awesome job. They've gone out there, raised the Ghanaian flag. Most of the players that were part of the COSAFA under 17 winning title team have actually come back and given back to the team. And you're thinking women's football is going places. If we win this trophy, then perhaps that speaks volumes about how much success we're achieving.
We all knew this was not going to be an easy tournament for the Crested Cranes.
Yeah.
And I remember, like I said at the beginning of the show, as one of my highlights, I was pretty surprised, you know, how they've come up with some good performance against the big teams. And the game against Kenya, we knew that, you know, Uganda, the Crested Cranes and Faliga, they wanted to beat Kenya and avoid playing against Tanzania, who I think have been the best side in the tournament. But again, if you want to be the best, you have to be the best team there. Now, at the semifinals, I think that's the most important thing. How can they go about this? Does, you know, Feldenberg have enough to progress to the next round? Yes, they can. The girls, you know, they have a good mentality. And I think for me, the most important thing is that they have that serial winning mentality. They never stop even when they lose. So I think coming into the game against Tanzania, they have to give it their best. Like Ryan said, the way they conceded the goals against Kenya, that was so awful. I really thought they could have done much better than they did. They've been doing well. And I think for me, their last games, they were not conceding a lot of goals. I was quite shocked how they conceded those 3 goals in such a short time. But again, that's football. Such things happen. So this game against Tanzania, I have to think twice. It's going to be a very, very tough game for the Crested Cranes.
Nick, it's a replay of last year's final down in Rwanda, and the Cranes will be hoping that they've learned from the mistakes they made in their previous outing and they can get better now.
Well, getting better would be the motive or the objective for Bodega, but right now you want to worry for them after what we saw against Kenya.
Yeah.
Tell you what, we got carried away when we had that, you know, thrashing of the victory against Djibouti.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I thought maybe at that point it was too much credit given to them because you're beating up a very weak side. Got to Ethiopia, got really tested, got a slim victory. So it was very lucky for us to get all 3 points. Faced Kenya, I thought maybe Bulega would have fielded a much stronger side or maybe rested a few players for the knockout stage knowing that they had already qualified with a game to spare. But now you face a Tanzanian side, the host nation, pretty much the favorites to come out again and defend their title, how they won it last year. But take nothing away from the Crested Cranes. From what we saw in the COSAFA, I think we can carry that, or they can carry that, into the semi-finals and try to better, not to concede, because once you concede, it's a huge setback. How do you recover from that? We know for a fact we've got very good, prolific strikers, Narukenge, Fauzia, Waput, among others. And even then, the leadership of Ruth Atoro in goal will be very, very key. So I'm hoping that tonight could be a winner for Bodega and Company.
All right, Dennis Onyango, one of the 55 players in the running for the CAF Best 11 for the year 2019. When we come back, we'll be talking that. Plus, Jose Mourinho, he says, I'm not going to make the mistakes that I have made in the past. Well, we'll discuss that and so much more after the break. You're watching Game On, it's Fun Friday, and we're definitely powered by 1xBet.
Game on. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game On is brought to you by...
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.